Welcome, Berks County viewers, and welcome to the weekly edition of The Generation Gap. In particular, I'd like to invite the viewers from Robinsonia and Wernersville, because today the topic is going to be the 2016 election for the presidency. And the people that we'll be sharing this time slot with are the honors class at Conrad Weiser High School, honors in problems of democracy, their political science course. So we'll be joining some members from Conrad Weiser in a few minutes. So if the scouts can hear me, you're certainly welcome to come on in. Hey there, how are you today?
I'm great, how are you?
I'm okay. I'm gonna ask you for a favor. And can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Okay, the favor is going to be that when you introduce yourself, after you're finished with your commentary, and you pack, could you ask all of the members of your group to just give me their first name?
Yep.
Because I'm at that point where a lot of things kind of slip by me, and my name is Mike Schorn. I'm sorry, I am filling in today, and I'm a little bit rusty. So,
gotcha.
I think your topic is great, and why don't you go ahead and talk about, you know, how you arrived at the topic. Obviously, it is only a week away, but...
Yeah. First we'll introduce ourselves. I'm Adam Snyder.
You're Matt.
What?
You can just stay on and talk, and then when you're finished and when you pass it, the next person just introduce themselves. Would that be okay? You're going to introduce your topic, right?
Okay, yeah. So our topic today is the 2016 election. Okay. And our first question for you is, have you ever seen an election like this?
In my lifetime? No, I have not. No, I don't know anyone who is living today has ever seen anything like this.
Yeah. Okay.
So you're asking me questions, but I'm sure that is there any conflict among your group? I mean, are you all feeling the same way about this election?
I think we're pretty... A lot of us have different opinions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's good. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah.
Go right ahead. You start off.
Okay. Well, can I introduce everybody?
Sure. I'm okay. Sorry. You go right ahead.
So I'm Adam.
Okay, Adam.
I'm Will.
Hey, Willie.
Hi, I'm Allie.
Hi, Allie.
My name is Rosalie.
Hi, Rosalie. Welcome.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Abby.
And
I'm
Abby.
Sarah.
Sarah. Welcome, Sarah.
I'm Allie.
I'm Claire.
Hi, Claire. Okay, we're back. And you're Matt, right?
Adam.
Adam. That was good. What a bad start that was. Go right ahead, Adam. The floor is yours, as they say.
I just wanted to see if you could expand just what you think about this election and how you think it's going.
So, Adam, you want to put me on the hot seat?
Definitely.
Why did you do this? Do you have a faculty sponsor there today with you?
Like a teacher?
Yes.
Oh yeah, we have our government teacher right behind the camera.
Okay. Okay, now, did he put you guys up to this? Because now I'm supposed to bare my soul here. Is that what you want me to do?
We're getting out of homework for this.
Well, I don't blame you for that. That's good. No, I've never seen anything like it. To say quite honestly, I've been a Democrat all my life, okay? But I'd like for you to know, since you asked me this question, is what I'd like you to know is I always felt that I was independent. You either are a Democrat or a Republican in the city of Reading, because if you're an independent, you don't get a voice. You don't, in the, at least in the primary election, you don't. So my family and I, I've been born and raised a Democrat. My wife and I have five daughters, and each one of them and their families are much different. You know what I mean? So they have different views and different opinions. I'd like to consider myself always an independent. I try to vote for the person, the individual whom I feel is best qualified or will do the best job, not necessarily the party.
Yeah.
I hope that answers a little of your question.
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
I'd pass it off to someone else for a question.
Oh, Adam, you're doing well. Yeah. We have 50 minutes, so go right ahead. You can fire away with any question you want and pass it along or do whatever you'd like.
Okay, any question. What do you think about the negativity in this campaign?
Well, you know, what I like to do is I like to hear commentators who do fact checks. Yeah. You know, they're checking the facts, you know, what people say and what they don't say. And, you know, it's quite a revelation, depending on, where you stand, but it's quite a revelation to me that so many things that have been stated by both candidates are not totally accurate. You know, some are wide exaggerations and others are just outright unfounded truths. I think that, Adam, I think what's worse in my heart is the amount of money that has been spent on ads, whether it be the presidential election or whether it be actually the McGinty, the race, over $115 million just for the state senator's race.
Yeah.
And I keep on thinking, I was a school teacher all my life. So I follow the consequences of Conrad Weiser. I know the difficulty with regard to making a school budget and not increasing taxes. And it's the same in my district in Reading. Obviously, much, much different demographics. But the issues are pretty much the same, Adam.
Yeah.
And I think of all the money that was spent just, for example, on those two campaigns, it's pretty ludicrous.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So from the negativity point, I didn't mean to skirt that, but I just think it's hurtful to me to see those things. I don't have any control over it. Quite honestly, I'm sick and tired of seeing the same commercials over and over again. Do you happen to feel that way at all?
Yeah. Yep.
I mean, the same ones. I mean, at least be a little clever and do something a little different, you know, but... it's awful. It's awful.
Okay, I agree with you.
Thank you.
Anyone else want to weigh in on this?
Someone wants to talk to me, I'm sure, right?
Yes, of course.
Great.
I had a question similar to that. In one of the town hall debates that we watched, I believe it was a school teacher had asked the question on whether or not it was appropriate and if both the candidates were modeling appropriate behavior for students. I mean, like many of us, one of our assignments was to watch the debate.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering what your thoughts were about whether or not just the behavior that they're modeling is appropriate for students like us.
Well, the behavior and some of the things that are stated, I have to look at it this way. No, they are not. I think the modeling, if you want to use that term, that verb, the modeling that we have seen on occasion has been very poor, in my opinion. I think that what you must take into consideration is that you have in Hillary Clinton a lifelong politician. You know, other than the fact that for 30 plus years she has been a part of politics. You know, so she knows the catchphrases, the keywords, and she actually knows the issues because her husband lived through them, and obviously I think that is a terrific advantage. There is no question, I don't believe anyone on your panel would disagree with this, but if you put the two candidates side by side and you listen to them speak about issues or about almost anything, even in response to questions, Hillary Clinton is a far better communicator. Her style and what have you. I mean, she was born and bred into the political arena. Donald Trump, I'm trying to be kind here, but if anyone doesn't realize his braggadocio and his narcissism, that is certainly a deterrent toward him. You know, and it just seems like he does not have the refined ability to speak semantically and in time intelligently to some of the issues. He comes off, you know, as a C minus, where she is getting an A, in my humble opinion. Mm-hmm. However, I do believe that the man is bright. I think he's very intelligent, and I think that some of his goals or his initiatives or some of the things that he stated 14, 15 months ago when he first started this, I think they're very good. I haven't heard that from the other side. I think that some of his concerns, especially the one on national security, I think that the comments that are associated with him are kind of misguided, because he just did not do a real good job of polishing what it was he was saying, in my humble opinion.
Thank you.
No, thank you. You guys are asking me my opinion. I'm going to get burned here. Has anyone there noticed that for the first time, even I'm assuming that most of you are 18 or about to be 18, so many of you, if not all of you, would be able to vote this time around. But I have never seen so few signs in yards. So few. I mean, I was involved a little bit after I left teaching in the political process, and I'm not a big fan of yard signs and all of that. You know, I think that some of that, it breeds a lot of contempt. And I think that you've seen that because there have been some races where people have taken exception to people who are in the race. For example, Senator Toomey, his neighborhood was vandalized with all types of graffiti. His properties were somewhat destroyed, not permanently, but temporarily. And, you know, it just seems like there's really a kind of a hatred in this campaign. And it's very sad. And this is probably the most important campaign of my lifetime, because I don't know where we're going to go with national security. That is an absolute essential, in my opinion.
Thank you. I think we have another question.
Oh, that's great. Thank you.
Hi. I was thinking today, this is the first big shift in power that our generation has seen since the Obama administration came in 8 years ago. And I was 10 when that happened. I really didn't have a voice when it came to politics. But now that I'm 18, and this is such a huge election, it's kind of awe-inspiring to make this decision when this is the only person I've ever known as president is President Obama. And now I have two drastically different people who are very much drastically different than Obama as well to vote for president. And I think my generation has a hard time depicting what is best for America, since all we've ever known for America is Obama. Do you have any opinions on this matter or views?
No, I think that's why I kind of said that this is the most important election of my lifetime. I mean, it has to do with the selection of the Superior Court justices, which that's a whole other topic that you and I and your panel could discuss along with your teacher. But in my humble opinion, when I see some of the Supreme Court justices in action and I listen to them, I think they should have been retired 10, 12 years ago. I mean, you know, I said to you when I started this program that I'm a little rusty at this because I haven't done. I used to do this and be in here and talk with you guys for years. And I had a program that I talk with young kids, but I haven't been involved for a while. And I just think that people who get to a certain age, as Supreme Court justices, I think that there should be term limits, or there should be an age where people have to get off and let somebody else do it. And that also goes for the politicians all across the Senate, the House, and the state level. I just don't think that being in office for 35, 40, 45 years is helpful. I think that if you're going to go into office and you say that you're going to serve your constituents, I think that you do a really good job or could do a good job in two or three terms, and that's final. I think that after that, I think you kind of, it just becomes matter of fact. Mm-hmm. You lose your enthusiasm for what it is that you want to do. you guys today, you and your classmates, you're very anxious as seniors, you're very anxious to discuss and talk about politics, not just with me, but you've done this now for some time, you know, in your class and among yourselves. But, you know, after a while, if you were doing this 6-7 years or something like that, it might wear off. That's really what I'm trying to say, and I think that the term limits for politicians at all levels would be very helpful. I just don't think that people my age been hanging around for 25, 30 years. I just think they're out of touch, or they can be. I mean, not everybody, but I think a majority of them.
Yes,
now, I'll make you laugh right now, okay? I'm going to make you laugh. I'm going to tell you something. I don't own a cell phone. Okay, so, you know, like I came from a generation, I started teaching in 1968, and my job or my task was to try to teach students how to write sentences, to develop their thoughts, put them into paragraphs, and make that structure proper. Okay, and I taught in the Reading schools my entire life, and most of my career, most of it, I enjoyed. When politics got involved, I did enjoy it. And after so many years, you just feel as if, hey, I've been here, you know, and I know the ropes, and I see people coming in and they want to make changes because they want to put their imprint on everything. And that's not always healthy. You know, you're 12 years into schooling, and I can't imagine how many times math, perhaps science, certainly English, the changes have been made in the curriculum at different levels. It's incredible. I mean, I learned my tables one way. I still understand my tables, but I can't teach my grandchildren when they bring their books home. I don't understand how that is being taught anymore. To me, it was simplistic. Today, I think it's much more difficult.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. And it's probably best that we have new people coming, circulating in all the time to address new issues that arise in our country, because we can't have the same people addressing new issues if they're older and they have experience with other issues. They won't react the same way that they should directly to the issues that we have now.
Very good point. Nice job with that point. I didn't say this, but my point is I could never go back into the classroom today because everything has changed. There was so much respect and there was so much discipline when I began teaching in the late 60s and early 70s. You know, we didn't have the wholesale disrespect that you see some schools. You know, I picked up the paper today in preparation for coming here, and I saw that in Allentown yesterday, I don't know if you guys saw that or heard it on the news, 70-some people were involved in a fight at the high school. You know, they arrested 7, 2 were in critical condition. That just wasn't a part of the way I grew up. I'm not saying we didn't have disagreements and we didn't have some fights, but nothing wholesale like it is today. It's way beyond me. I don't understand it, but I feel for my grandchildren who are a little younger than you. You know, I don't want them caught up in this in all this negativity, if possible.
Thank you. I believe some of my classmates have some more things to say.
Thank you.
Okay, I have a question for you. Do you think that political experience is crucial to being elected the president?
I'm sorry, did I cut you off?
No, go ahead.
No, I'm going to relate that question to my own experience. I retired in 2000 teaching after 32 years, and 2 days after I handed in my retirement papers, I became a city council member for the city of Reading. Now, unlike you guys who are working with the political, and you're getting some feeling about politics and the election and the whole process, I didn't have any background to be a city councilman. I had none. But, you know, I took it on as a new challenge. It was something new to me. And I spent 6 years trying to do it. Actually, I did run for mayor, and I said, well, if I win, I'm only going to serve one term, because I wanted to put everything that I had into that effort to try to make things better and to make things fair. But I was defeated, and I had also stated that the following year I would I would leave council, giving someone else an opportunity to take my spot. But I had no experience. But if you're talking about the President of the United States, I do believe it's someone who has some experience with regard to the processes would certainly have an advantage as to someone who has no experience. Now, having said that, I believe the processes at the federal government are really, really screwed up. And I believe that because the one body doesn't support the other body, and nobody seems to want to support the president, whether you like him or you don't. And I have a feeling that regardless of whom is elected next week, I have a feeling that that individual is going to face the same hardships as the president has faced the past 8 years and the president before him faced the previous 8 years. I think this past 8 years was worse than anything else probably in the history as far as working together. But to answer your question, I didn't mean to go on and on, but I do believe obviously that some political experience is necessary.
And I do agree with that. I think that you need to learn how the government works before you can come in and be the leader of our country.
Now, I will say that on a much smaller level, the city of Reading is still the fifth largest city in the Commonwealth. On a smaller level, our form of government that we have here, I really worked at trying to understand it. And I'd say that by the time I left, my term was over, I understood it about halfway. You know what I mean? I think, and I really put a lot of time, energy, and effort into it. I just think that there is so much which then supports your thought that you have to have some experience.
Yes.
Excuse me, I think that would be very beneficial.
Okay.
I just want to just take a second to let the folks know who may have tuned in right now that we're talking to these terrific students from Conrad Weiser High School. It's from their honors class. It's your political science. Is it POD? Do you call it that or what?
Government and politics.
Government and politics, okay. And we're talking to our Conrad Weiser friends here, so they're doing a wonderful job. And we also want to thank BCTV, and we want to thank Fulton Bank for allowing this program every week, every Friday, to continue. So, but thank you. Do you have another question for me?
Yes.
Hi,
good morning.
So you said earlier that this was the most important election of your lifetime, and I was wondering why you had that opinion.
You know, that's a good question too. I think only because the tone of this election for the past 14 months, the tone has been so ugly and so hate-filled. It does not comprise just the two candidates. It's a composition of all of the parties and all of the elected people and how they take jabs at one another. And more important than that, I personally don't believe that someone's personal comment May 11 or 12 years ago in a back room should necessarily be used over and over and over again to demean someone. And then the counter of that is that, we've seen that the other demeaning comments about the other candidate, and it's over and over again. I believe that there is such a lack of privacy. That's why I said that. I think that the tone in our country today is so overbearing that it scares me. It's not just the two people who are running for, well, actually there are four, and so that we're slighting the independents, the Green Party and the Libertarian Party, and I didn't mean to do that. But quite honestly, as an independent, or as one of those members, you're never going to get enough votes. I mean, everything is going to be concentrated on the two major parties. unless things change in the future. But that's why I said that. And I said that, and I think I don't mean to repeat myself, but I said it because of the assignments and the people who are going to be put in place. I think that's important. I do believe that Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton have both missed their mark. I think that if they would have shared in their third and final discussion, if they would have shared some of the people whom they think they would like to see in various positions, I think that would have helped the American people make some other decisions too. You know, for example, I've been following the vice presidential candidates, I think that that's important, that, you know, we get to get a little feel for them too, you know, and whether or not one couldn't perform, can the other, and do you like the second choice, you know, and so. From that standpoint, that's kind of why I said it was the most important. I guess it's like was stated earlier. Never seen anything like it. I've never seen anything like it. You and you guys, hopefully, will see a more refined election in years to come. That's why I meant.
Do you think that the media is biased for or against a certain candidate?
I do. Yes, I do. I think that the media has been very anti-Trump, rather than saying that it's pro-Clinton, which by default would be true. But I think that they have gone out of their way to find every little nodule of poor taste or bad taste, you know, to throw against Trump. But you know what? He very easily does this to himself. I mean, I've never ever seen anybody who puts his foot in his mouth more than he does. You know, that's just my opinion. You know, but I really do like some of his issues, some of the issues that he brought 14 months ago to the forefront. I think are very important. It's just that I just wish he had a better way. I think he sometimes just thinks he's still on the reality show, you know, where he can fire everybody. That obviously has hurt him.
Hi. How do you feel about Donald Trump's plan to build a wall between the United States and Mexico?
Well, you know what, whether that's a figure of speech or whether that is absolutely literal, I don't know, but I think that what he was trying to say there, and he did a very poor job of doing it, was that there has to be some kind of border fencing or some kind of protection there, because people just seem to have the ability to come into our country, you know, without anyone stopping them. I mean, we do have Border Patrol people, Texas and Arizona. There are many Border Patrol agents, but people still find a way to sneak in, and I think that was his the reason that he was saying that. The way he said it, and he backtracked a couple of times on it, but you know, like when you put it out there initially, it's really hard to backtrack. I think that what he was trying to do was he was just trying to say that there are just so many illegal people in our country. He also said that there are many of the illegals who are not criminals are out there taking jobs from Americans, from the citizens. And, you know, he just did not do a really good job of explaining what he really meant, you know, in my opinion. You know, I'm watching this numerous times now, and I'm saying to myself, just say what you really mean there, rather than just generalize. He did a poor job of that, in my opinion. Oh, I should say, everything that you're asking me is my opinion. So if I go out here today from BCTV and my car's not there, then we're going to blame it on this program, because you allow me to bare my soul here.
Hello. How do you feel the accusations towards Hillary and Donald influence the way people vote?
Could you repeat that again?
Yeah. How do you feel the accusations towards Hillary and Donald influence the way people vote?
Well, I think that there are a number of independents throughout our country. I don't know what the number will be, and they're probably wrestling with their decision yet. I do believe that this will be the largest public election in history. I think there will be more votes cast than ever before, if for no other reason than all of the people who have been signing up, you know, all of the efforts that are out there from different camps, just getting people like yourselves to sign up and to register for the, and to vote for the first time. I think it'll be amazing. I think that the winner will probably have something like 58 to 60 million votes. And I think that the loser will probably still come in at 48 million, something like that. So I don't believe it'll be more than about 4 points, 4.5, maybe 5 points maximum. But the comments that you asked me about and the commentary that I mentioned a couple times to your classmates has been just brutal. Just brutal. And I think one of your classmates had asked about the modeling. It's just awful. That's why I say that. There's nothing really, really good about this election coming out of either candidate, other than the fact that I think that the Clinton camp is so polished. The mechanisms are in place. They have all the mechanics. They know what to do. They have the support and the volunteers. I'd love to see how much money has been spent just by the Clintons on this campaign for advertisement. You know what I mean? Certainly way outdistance Trump's campaign. I'm sure Trump could put the money up and he could get it, but he's not getting any support from his own party, you know, where Clinton is. Clinton's, you know, they have Colin Powell on board now, and of course, the president's wife is out on board. She's out supporting Hillary Clinton. And so she has an awful lot of support. People are going out and doing all kinds of rallies and things for her. I don't see the same coming from the people on the other side.
Yeah, I agree.
Sure.
Okay. Another question I have is, since you say that you're a Democrat, how would you feel if Donald Trump was elected?
I said that I was a registered Democrat, okay, from the time that I was your age. But I also said to you that I always felt I was independent. Okay, so I'm a registered Democrat, but I believe that I have always voted my conscience. I have never ever just voted because I'm a Democrat. I think that people on both sides, because they say that they're a Democrat or they say that they're a Republican, and they just vote party line. I think that's their choice, certainly, but I don't believe that that's the way to go. I believe that people should be independent, be concerned about who the candidates are, do some homework, and try to select a person whom they feel is best suited for the job. But that's the way I look at it. You know, I hope that I answered your question, other than the fact that I guess you asked me, well, what if Donald Trump were elected? If Donald Trump is elected, I will certainly do whatever minimal amount I can do to be a supportive American. That's what Kennedy asked of us in 1961. He asked not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. So, you know, in my small regard, I can do what I do, and that is support and support whomever has been elected. I mean, I supported Barack Obama, and there are a lot of things about Barack Obama's tenure that I like, and there are a lot of things that I don't like. I'm not a fan of Obamacare. I knew that what was going to happen was going to happen, and that is that the people are bailing out now, and premiums are rising. I knew that that would happen. Not that I'm a fortune teller, but everyone else said that it will happen, but it was going to take time. And of course, this is an election year. That's one of the reasons it's happening now. But I would support Trump as best I can. I'm not going to go around bad-mouthing, but I'll do the same with Hillary Clinton. And there are a lot of things about Hillary Clinton that I do not like. Those of you there, I'm sure that you've probably studied a little bit about the Clinton Foundation. It was revealed in the last 48 hours that over the last, 16 years, that there has been close to $2 billion that has been put into the Clinton Foundation, and that's 64% of the money that has been placed there has gone for good causes, for charitable causes and what have you. But there are 35-36% of that money that has been used for private planes and travel and different things like this. So, you know, on the one hand, there's a lot of good that's been done. And on the other hand, you know, $2 billion is an awful lot of money. And I don't know if, I'm sure that you do not know this, you and your classmates, but when Bill Clinton left the White House after 8 years, the Clintons owed the Democratic National Committee over $80,000. They were, in fact, broke. They had no money. Now they have hundreds of millions of dollars in their own account and had $2 billion in the last 16 years placed into the foundation. So when you look at those kinds of numbers and you look at how the money was arrived at, it does lead to some questions.
Okay, thank you.
You're very welcome.
Another question. Do you have any questions for us to answer?
Do I have any what?
Any questions for us?
Yeah, I'm going to ask one, and that is, I think there are 8 or 9 of you on the panel there?
Yeah.
I was wondering if you would tell me how much division is among your 8 or 9. Do you have some people with strong views one way and then others with stronger views another way? Do you have that? Does everyone feel the same on your panel?
No. I mean, some of us are very liberal, some of us are very conservative, and some of us are in the middle.
I see.
Like, for example, I like Donald Trump. I'm not a big Hillary fan, and there's people over there that are they like Hillary and they despise Donald Trump, and so there's definitely a lot of division between us. And you see it in government class, and even I think this election is so much different than like the Mitt and Obama election that people like actually our age are getting really into it, and they
they're
watching the news, and in school, like we're actually talking about it, and I think that's really cool.
Well, not only is it cool,
yeah,
but it's very healthy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That someone would talk about it. I think that's it may not seem healthy. It may not seem healthy with your panel, mm-hmm. but to me, I think it is very healthy that you can, in a civilized way, that you can express different views, you know, and not be disrespected in so doing. I think earlier you may have heard me say that I just feel for the people because there are I don't know in Robinsonia and Wernersville if there are any signs out on the lawns, but there are very, very few in the city. And when a city has an election for a city function, for example, our mayor, Mayor Scott, Wally Scott, when that election took place, there were tens of thousands of signs out.
Yeah.
But I think some people feel that if they put a Trump sign out, that there's going to be some kind of damage done to them, or there's going to be repercussion, because that's one of the reasons I said earlier that I believe that this election may be closer than you think, because I think there are a lot of people who just aren't saying a whole lot, aren't talking about Trump for fear that they're not going to be taken very seriously or that there's going to be some repercussion. And I think that I think that perhaps there may be some foolery there. I don't know if he has enough votes to win, but I think that it's going to be surprising. I would be surprised if he does not get 44, 45 million votes.
Yeah, I definitely think there's a silent majority that does want Trump to win, and they're just not saying it because they're scared that people are going to say bad stuff to them.
You know that has happened.
Yeah.
You know, people with Trump signs. I mean, look at some of the rallies and the protesters and some of that kind of stuff. It was just awful.
How the GOP building got firebombed in North Carolina. And
right.
Some people are scared to say that they like Trump.
Yeah.
Because they don't really know how to defend themselves sometimes, and same thing for Hillary.
Yeah, I don't see as much repercussion with regard to people who support Hillary, but the fact that you have very few Republicans who are coming out and supporting you, you know, and including your some of the big hitters who are Republican, some of the big Republican names, they've withdrawn their support, or they're very quiet about it. You know, they're not throwing over any money that way. And you know what is interesting, though? I'm sure you guys are aware of the WikiLeaks, the email scandal.
Yes.
Does anyone there talk about the fact that it has, you know, it's buried like on page 17, or, you know, as opposed to being front page fodder?
Yeah, well, like I'll go after school and I'll like go on CNN and they're still talking about all the ladies accusing Donald Trump of sexual harassment and stuff like that. And there's really been no proof like with any of it. And like I know it should be taken seriously, but they're really not covering anything bad about Hillary. They'll like mention something about WikiLeaks, but they'll say that it's hacked, so it might not be able to be believed. But like, just stuff like when you see that like John Podesta, her campaign manager, is like having dinners with the people trying her for her emails. Like I don't get how you can look past that.
Well, there are and have been ethics concerns all over the place. You know, and I think it, you know, when switch gears now, I think that when Donald Trump makes a statement that he hasn't paid taxes in 19 years or something like that. I mean, all those, I mean, in some regards, when I say to you he is a bright guy, he is also one of the dumbest guys with regard to not thinking through what he's saying or going to say.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, someone in the capacity of Donald Trump, with all the buildings and all the architecture and everything that he has developed, you know, if you're going to use the tax code and appropriately use the deductions that are allowed, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But don't come out and brag about it. You know what I mean? Your mom and dad, and my folks, you know, we probably paid more taxes than he has. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's that's one of the reasons why I say that this is just such a terribly crazy election.
Yep.
Because of the taste that is in a lot of people's mouths, not good.
Yeah. Okay.
Anything else, you guys?
Yeah.
Hey, before you say anything, if anyone would like to call and talk to these guys here at BCTV, you can. It's 610-378-0426. And that's a generality that I say, talk to these guys. I meant to say these guys or these gals, right? Both of you. So we have about 10 minutes left, so what can I do for you? What question can I answer?
I was actually going to answer the question between the divide. When I'm looking at the divide between these two people, I've always been more worried about how the foreign policy will work. And I believe if Hillary gets in the office, other countries will not take us seriously, and the same with Trump. That's why I'm kind of stuck in the middle here, because I feel Trump will have a much stronger foreign policy. But Hillary will have an equally a strong one, but she won't be taken seriously by nations in the Middle East that frown upon women in charge. And those are the nations we really need to take advantage of right now with ISIS and all the dangerous things that are happening in Syria.
Well, I think the genesis of your question was whether or not, for example, Hillary as a woman is going to be viewed as someone who is one way or another. I think when you say that you think Trump would probably do a better job with regard to foreign relations or national security, I don't know. I would hope that either one of them would be their number one goal, to keep us safe. That is their job. It's the job of the presidency and the government to make sure that Americans are safe. I don't know. I do know this, that was Donald Trump's, one of the first things that he said, that was going to be a concern or a forte of his, that he was national security. I mean, everything that he has stated, whether he stated it very well or whether he stated it poorly, has to do with security for our country. You know, even, for example, the vetting of the Syrians and the Middle East, he didn't say that very well. I mean, he kind of like came off as saying that, well, we're not going to let any of the Muslims in. It's all their fault. But what he really was saying was he wanted to have a vetting process before we just simply add people in. And I don't think that anybody can say that wasn't of some good advice. I think he's talking about the fact that we have open borders and that has created some problems in our country over the last few years. And he'd like to see those particular areas, he'd like to see those crafted better so that we have more security.
Okay.
Did I answer your question?
Yes, sir, you did. Thank
Are
you.
Are you sure? Are you sure? I'm hoping I did.
I think this election is very hard because you hear all the allegations and not a lot of people are following the policies, especially during debates. Like, they don't talk about their policies and their plans as much as they do, like, insulting each other. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very hard for, like, the younger generation to, like, I don't know, make an opinion on, because, like, you hear all the media outlets just talk about, oh, this person's horrible, but this person's more bad, and...
Well, let me ask you, when you communicate at school, in your class, isn't there a sense of civility and a sense of respect shown?
There is.
Right. So, what you have experience watching those debates, it's kind of like verbal wrestling. I mean, it's awful, and a couple of your classmates stated that earlier. You know, it's just not the way it's supposed to be. That's why I say I've never seen anything like it, because you're supposed to stick to issues. I do blame some of this on the MCs. They let people go on and on. Now, maybe it's a lot easier for me to say, hey, rein them in and let's stick to the issues or the topics. But, you know, they have to do a better job too. And I like all of the guys and the gals that were involved in that. But, it was like a runaway train.
I feel like it's very hard too, like for students, especially going into college, they haven't talked about the issues of education and making college more affordable, and they don't have any plans for us in our future and leading us.
Well, you know, Bernie Sanders was really big on those topics, and he had a tremendous following. You know, if you go back and you look at the Democratic race from the beginning, Bernie Sanders really did one heck of a job. I mean, there were an awful lot of people who were very enamored and supportive of him. I personally don't think that the things that he wanted to do are possible. Not all of them. I mean, there is no way that in this day and age that you could offer totally free education. You just could not do that. That's impossible. But is there I'll share something else with you that's not related to the politics. There is absolutely no way that you can do away with school taxes totally. If you did away with school taxes totally, I don't care if they say that they're going to bump up other taxes. That would be the end of public education. In 3 years, it would be over. They can do something with school taxes. They could do something for seniors or people who have lived in their house for 30, 40, 50 years. They could do something there. But there are just so many things that these people, they say and they tell everybody that they're going to do. They can't do them. It's impossible to do that. I've noticed that I only have a couple of minutes, that we only have a couple of minutes left. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to say I, because it's been your show. I want to tell you, thank you very much for you and your panel for sharing this today. You asked me the questions, and yeah. I hope that that I was able to answer them at least the way I feel, honestly and fairly and somewhat intelligently. Really appreciated this, and like I say, I haven't been here for a while, so I've been a little rusty. But I certainly wish you well. Are you going to school? Do you have plans to go?
I am, yes.
May I ask where, or do you have?
I'm going to a two-year program at Harcum College.
Oh, okay. And I'm sorry. And what's going to be your major?
It's called histotechnology. It's a hospital lab job.
Oh, okay. My wife and daughter were nurses, so I wish you the very best.
Thank you.
It's a wonderful career. Can be very challenging, though.
Yes.
And then I talked to any of your others, any of the other kids, students. Where are you going to school? Are you going to school?
I'm probably going to Immaculata University in Philly. And I would want to be a nursing major.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And, good for you.
Yeah.
I think you probably know this, obviously, before you go. Immaculata, is that a 4 or 5 year program for a master's?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I like it there. Great school.
Okay. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Hi. Yeah. I attend Bloomsburg, Bloomsburg University for molecular biology.
For biology?
Yeah, molecular biology.
Oh, for microbiology. Going to Bloomsburg?
Yes.
Okay. Don't forget, if you're going to go to Bloomsburg or IEP or any of those schools, you have to take warm clothing when you go.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's very, very, very cold there. Anywhere up in the mountains, boy. But good luck to you. That's great.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for everything that you guys did for me today. I appreciate it.
Hi, I'm planning to go to Millersville University to major in Spanish education.
To major in?
Spanish education. I want to be a Spanish teacher.
Oh, you're going to be a Spanish major. Well, that certainly is a very wise choice. I'm sure that there are plentiful opportunities for someone who has mastered the language. So you'd be bilingual, and that will go a long way. So listen, I probably couldn't get to everyone. I'm down to my last 50 seconds or so. Can I just pass on that I wish you, all of you, the very best, those of you who are going to be voting for the first time, and for the viewing audience, please, despite all of this and all of the conversation, make sure you cast your ballot. That is your American right as a citizen. All of you, best wishes to you. Thank you for putting up with me today. I hope my answers were okay. Again, this is Mike Schorn. I'm going to be signing off. I thank you all in Berks County for tuning in today and watching these fine young people from Conrad Weiser. Way to go, Scouts, and I'll look forward to the next time that I'm asked to be on here. I'm very humbled to be here today, and I appreciate it. Thank you very much for the time. Thank you, Fulton Bank, for your sponsorship of this wonderful program, and thank you, BCTV. Until later. Good night.